Martin's water cutting like a cactus.
I'm a bad brain, Bruce Wayne in the fast lane. Couple J's in the ashtray, style motherfucker. Tattoo back, man, see the rap name. Take a bath in the champagne, wow, motherfucker. Straight from the block, dog, duck a shot. Walking to the stove, dollar four, black a mile, motherfucker. Blew up as a rock star, so I'm top floor. Throwing drinks on a cop car, foul, motherfucker. The only number calling up my phone is from a dealer, swear that dude will not leave me alone. Casinos when I pick up.
Raw and uncut. Telling you what's up.
Yeah.
You're lifting with the Husky Boy Barbenders.
Yeah.
Bending some bars.
Mm-hmm.
Y'all know what it is. What we getting into today, Bruce?
Today we getting into the last three weeks? 3 weeks? It's been
three weeks? Yeah, it's an update. We got to update the peoples.
3 week update on the Husky Boy lifestyle. And number two,
the fact that you were wilding out in Miami with Marcus, right?
Man, hot boy summer.
Hot boy summer 2019.
Hot boy summer 2019.
How's your hip doing, man?
My hip is kind of, I don't know, it's kind of weird. I think it's just inflamed now. I've been doing a lot of physical therapy. Or not a lot, but twice a week I go to physical therapy.
Yeah.
They make me do like leg raises, side raises, back raises. And then they'll make me do that like standing on one leg.
Yeah,
like kicking front, back, forth, and it'll make me do it with like a cable assisted lift.
Are they trying to like strengthen it or like?
Yeah, they're trying to strengthen my hip and glute. Not really the front of the hip, like side of the hip.
Yeah,
and then the glute.
Okay.
And then they're trying to help me strengthen, or they're trying to help me loosen it as well, like doing some stretches and stuff. So. It's doing okay. He also made me do like body weight hack squats.
Okay.
And that was weird because I was like,
I haven't seen hack squats in a while.
That's what I'm saying. Like, I was like, he had me doing them and he was like, hey, don't worry if you can't go that low or whatever, or if this is a little bit too heavy. So I was doing it. I'm like, and he was like, oh, that's a little bit better than I thought you were going to do. I'm like, yeah, bro, I told you. Like, I've been.
Bro, you gotta put some respect on your name, bro.
That's what I'm saying. Like, don't
fuck out of here. Like, you know who we are.
So it's been good though. He's definitely acclimating to. I don't think he was expecting me to already kind of know a lot. One of the things my dad's a physician. He always hates when patients come in and they already think they know like the whole diagnosis and everything.
Right.
You know, the whole body. So I've just been trying to stay quiet and let him. Help like when he asks for help or help when he asks me for information and just let him like put me through a prognosis to get my hip right. And it's been going well. We've been making things like here and there every time I go, and he's been making things harder just because he sees that like a lot of stuff we did at first was so easy. Like it was like at first it was like he was telling me to do some stretches that, I mean, most of the stretches he told me to do we already did during our warm-ups, like when we used to live.
Yeah.
So it wasn't anything that was new to me. And then most of the warm-ups he was telling me to do, those were part of a warm too. So I was like, this is really easy because I used to do this all the time. But I just stay quiet because I'm like, I don't know what his plan is. I don't want to like, you know, your physician. One thing people have to realize, and this is something for like everybody out there, whether you're going to the doctor because you have a cold or you're going to the doctor because you have an injury, you have to let your physician do what your physician does.
Right.
Your physician has like your physician has like a 10 week to 1 year long plan for your health that he's not going to communicate that whole thing to you. So you just have to trust your doctor, what your doctor is doing and telling you to do, because everything he's telling you to do is for a reason.
Right.
And if you go off of the protocol, then you're messing up his whole plan and you're messing up for your whole health. You're messing up the benefits to your health. Like, you're messing up your
right. And who went to fucking medical school? Not your ass.
Right, so. Not you. So, like, you do not know better than the doctor does. I mean, I don't care what you read on the internet. I don't care what you saw on YouTube. You do not know better than the doctor. Even if you do,
if you think you know better, get a second opinion. Don't put it on yourself.
Don't do it by yourself, yeah. And so, even if you do think you know better or you have a different like, way of doing it, your doctor may have a way of fixing you that will still work. It's just not the way you think should work. So, like,
right.
You could be doing A, B, and C when you're thinking of X, Y, and Z, and both do the right thing, but you cannot mess up A, B, and C because you still need to go from A to B to C in order for it to work. You can't just go do Y.
Did he ever tell you his plan?
No, I mean, we've just been going. I mean, I also, he didn't tell me yet, and I also don't want to know. So I have like a couple of, just to be honest, like if he believes he can fix me with what he's doing, that's enough for me. Like, I'm paying this dude. When you're paying someone to know what they're doing, that's all I need. All I need to know is I'm giving you money and you're doing the right thing. As soon as, you're not doing the right thing, I'll know because I'm not going to get fixed. So,
right. So where is surgery still in the plan for you? You think, or?
No, that's kind of off the plan. I still have a couple more weeks of PT before they even think about it, but I'll need to get it. I have a couple more weeks of PT before they want to give me an MRI. I only got an X-ray last time.
Is it like a flexibility issue or?
They think it's hip impingement. Just like your basic hip impingement, which to me, that's like the obvious easy answer. I mean, everything is impingement when you're hurt.
Yeah.
To some extent. If you lift, it's always impingement. And so they're trying to find out like where exactly the hip impingement is, just because when I was describing the injury and the times where I felt it, everybody's kind of looking at me like I was crazy. They're like, that doesn't make sense for where you're feeling the pain.
Oh, really?
So, yeah. I mean, like, because the pain is like, it's not muscular. Mm-hmm. It feels like a joint pain. And it's kind of like in the front of my hip at the joint. And so when I was telling them about it, they were like, that's a really weird hip pain, because usually hip pain is more in your groin, not like in the front of your, top of your quad.
Okay.
So they think it's more like glutes. Or like abductor and things.
Abductor, yeah.
Yeah, abductor.
Okay.
But, you know, I'm still trying to figure it out.
Well, at least, you know, it's not, as far as they know, it's not going to be a surgery issue, which is good.
Yeah.
That's a really good thing.
Nobody wants surgery.
Right. I know you would worry about that being, you know, 20, what are you, 24? Having that hip surgery is like not a cool thing.
Nah, that's not cool at all. That's big trash.
Well, for the past 3 weeks for me, I've just been, bro, I've been trying to stay in the gym. That shit hurt. I'm not going to lie. That shit hurt like hell. Like, I've been doing Stairmaster consistently. And then I'm trying to get to the point I can run again. I got some basketball shoes so I can play ball. I got some like freak. I thought they were college students, but some like high schoolers that'll play with me.
Well, they were high schoolers. Those are the most important to play sports with.
Dude, well, like, the thing is, like, they run a lot. Like, even, and it's, like, hot here. It's, like, that North Carolina heat, but it's Tennessee. And,
yikes.
Bro, it's 88 at night and humid, and they're running up and down the basketball court. And so,
you said 88 at night?
88 at night, bro. It hurts. But I try to get out there. I try to play basketball, like, twice a week. And other than that, I'm just doing the Stairmaster and trying to get to the point I can run again. I'm definitely better because the first week I started off, so I was doing the Stairmaster for 20 minutes, level 3, and my heart rate was averaging around 170. And so now it's on level 3, it averages around 150. So I'm trying to go up to like level 4, but it's like, it's such a big jump, it's been giving me problems. So like, what I've been doing this week is I'll go to level 4, I'll do it for 10 minutes, and then I'll get off and I'll go on the treadmill and I'll like walk / jog for 20. And so I can build myself up to being able to do the whole level 4 on the Stairmaster for 30 minutes straight. Because my goal is to get to the point where I can run on the Stairmaster, because I feel like that's just the perfect like cardio workout for somebody trying to lose weight.
Right.
And so right now, so I think last...
You want to run on the Stairmaster?
Dude, I want to run on the Stairmaster, bro.
That's
I'm trying to get like that extreme. I'm trying to get that fireman cardio. So like, this is what I don't understand, bro. Like firemen, even the buff firemen are like low key, like they're like fat. Like they're like, you never have just like a ripped fireman. It's just like they have big arms and big shoulders and that's it. But these motherfuckers be walking them steps. And so if they can do that shit, I feel like eventually I can. But I want to get to that point because I feel like if I can get to the point I can jog or run on the Stairmaster, then I've gotten back to the conditioning I had, you know, pre-college or during college when we were working out.
We used to do stairs at that part of the garage.
We used to run and jump to do like the stuff we did, like looking at it now, like seeing my fitness now and looking at what we did, like, we were, like, on some shit, bro. Like, some of the, like, it was some of the shit. And I, like, believe it or not, I always thought I was unathletic, bro. Because I couldn't keep up with you, Muhammad, and all of them. But, like, thinking about that shit now, I'm like, normal people can't fucking do what the fuck we used to do.
I was like, looking at some of, like, even the fact that we used to train twice a day.
Yeah. And we trained, like, hard. Like,
yeah,
like it wasn't no regular training, bro. Like, when we stopped working out, our morning workouts, like, especially chest, I was pushing, like, the hundreds for my six rep. Like, that's fucking ridiculous.
Right, yeah. Like, it was like sets of, it was sets of 6 to 10.
It was a pyramid. It was like 10, 8, 6, 8, 10. And I was going like 60, 80, 100. Like, what the fuck? Like, we were on some shit, bro. So, like, so it's been going good so far. So, I think last week I told you I was 281. I kind of had a setback over the weekend. So, I'm at 284 right now because I got a little bloated from eating too much. So, this week, back on, you know, trying to maintain my diet and stuff. And then hopefully by next week, I'll be down to 279 is my goal by next week.
Be lit.
And so, you know, I'm hoping I can just keep everything going and get keep it steady for right now. But my main thing is, man, I just want to be able to, like, run and play on the basketball court, bro. It's sad, like, I can't run, but I'm going to get there. I'm going to fucking get there.
Well, that's good. At least about time the Husky Boys gave an update because about the fitness industry has been in disarray.
Bro, they need us. I'm telling you.
The fitness industry needs us.
I swear, like, if somebody donated me a gym, I would be fucking, what's my man name? Who was it who just, like, put up a 2,000 total at Worlds? Was it Orhi?
Nah. I mean, Russ did it. He did an 1,800. Who put a 2,000?
Somebody put, like, a 1,900. Or was that Orhi?
Or he,
I don't remember I who it was. Somebody he put did, up something crazy.
10 times body weight, that's all I know.
Something crazy. Bro, I'll be back on that. Because, like, I'm going to tell you what I miss, and I hate it for the world, but it's, like, the most, I swear, like, it's the most, it's the thing that really wakes you up, is squatting. I miss squatting so much, bro. I miss, you know, working on form, watching that shit transform and stuff. That's the shit I miss, but, like, I just don't have the resources and time right now. But I'm telling you guys, Husky Boys are coming back. It's gonna happen. We're gonna get ourselves right, bro. This is the pre-workout right here. Pre-workout season right here, bro.
Hot boy summer. Husky boy summer.
I'm telling you. All right. So speaking of that shit, so like our friend Marcus just had a meet recently in Miami, and so I know he normally comes to you for stuff like. What y'all end up having to do in order to get everything set up to go out there?
Okay, so by the way, Muscle Man Marcus on Instagram.
Muscle Man Marcus fucking Marcus.
Muscle on Marcus nigga on your fucking bumper. Doofy, stupid, goofy.
Putting up some ignorant shit, bro. It's our man's though.
Yeah. Marcus just competed in the Ray Williams Classic in Miami at a Hybrid Performance Gym. Shout out to Steffi Cohen. I think she hosted at Hybrid Warren's gym is her gym. And she hosted the meet.
Shout out Steffi.
Shout out to Steffi Cohen, Aiden Bowe, and Ray Williams, which I saw Ray there. All of them were there, which was dope. at the meet. Ray Williams is probably one of the cool Ray Williams. Is a nigga.
Like, he's just a cool motherfucker.
Yeah, he's just a cool southern black dude. That's what.
See, I already know what he looked like just based off that description, bro.
So, it's just cool to hang out with people who are really cool. Like, there's a lot of. It's always weird when you're going to sports that are niche sports, like.
Yeah,
powerlifting or like ultimate frisbee or track and field is niche just because it's not unless you're like extremely skilled at it. Nobody cares what you do.
Facts.
Nobody cares
if that shit is not in a Facebook clickbait article. Ain't nobody gonna know.
Nobody cares. Yeah, and so it's all in sports like that. It tends to be that there's people who take it way too seriously, even though nobody cares about you. So it's always nice for people like Ray Williams and Steffi And like even Marcus is kind of at that elite level now. He is at that elite level now to where they're just cool. Like you go to them, they know it's not that serious. They know they're just doing, they know that you're not going to really get any money out of this sport. So they're just doing what they do because they like doing it. And
right.
They do other things on the side. They love to help people. They love to help more people get into the sport, because the more you get people into the sport, the bigger the sport gets. And now like we all can actually get a lick off of it, other than like going to paying $200 to go to a meet and then not getting anything for it other than like a plastic trophy.
Right.
Marcus was pretty much, everyone was pretty much competing for second against Marcus.
Damn, it was like that?
It was like that. Marcus had, I think he had the second highest total in the entire meet.
Get the fuck except out of here.
Except for one
bro.
Dude. I'm not even playing with you. Go on.
What's the website?
Go on. What's it called? Is it called Team Lift? Is it called? What is it called? Hold on. I'm going to tell you later.
All right. I'm going to throw that shit in the video. That's fine.
Right, there's a site you can go on, and I think people who powerlift will know what I'm talking about. There's a site you can go on that shows you the lift attempts and like the meet schedule for a meet, and you can see all of the results for that meet. It's an app. All powerlifting meets.
Oh, it's an app? Yo, that's fire.
Yeah.
See, I've been going too long, man.
All meets, most meets will use this by now, because we did not have this back in the day.
Hell no, bro. We had to wait for Jennifer Thompson to throw that shit on Facebook.
The same way, and when you join a meet, you see like the flight schedule, and you see who's up next and who's in the hole and all that. You can see that on the app, and it's like just posted for everyone and anyone to see.
That's amazing, bro. Why did we make that? We could have like made a dollar. That shit would have been,
bro. There's some things that I'm thinking about right now that I'm not gonna tell the world. That I'm about to make. It's gonna take me about a month to make it, and y'all gonna be looking at me like I'm crazy because I'm gonna be rich.
Hey, do it, bro. Put that shit out there.
So if you go on there and you look, you can see all the totals. You see Marcus's total for the 83. Marcus was, I think he weighed in around like 81 point something or 82 point something.
Mm. I heard he almost ain't make it because his water cut was coming close.
Hey, that water, Marcus water cutting like a cactus. I'm telling you, he like, he won't come out of it. I don't know what you want me. I don't know if he just
too I'm going to say it that way.
I don't know if he's just too lean and he just can't drop the water, but that water cut be hard for Marcus. But I mean, that's what happens when you get to an elite level. Like, it becomes a lot for you to keep everything pristine and perfect.
Right.
Make sure that you can hit all of your lifts and hit your body weight, hit your everything perfectly on that day. This is story time now. Story time with the Husky Boy Barbenders.
The Husky Boy Barbenders.
So we sitting there, right? We get there on, I think we get there on, Marcus got there on Thursday. I got there on Friday. Thursday, Marcus gets there. We're living in a duplex in the Airbnb we got. And the Airbnb next to us, there's like seven women at Airbnb. Mm-hmm. And all of them are on hot girls.
Oh, and no. So, oh, no.
I show up at the Airbnb. Marcus is there with his shirt off because he just be like that. And I walk up. The girl shakes my hand. She's like, "You are fine as hell." I'm like, "I already know I have to keep my chastity on because I'm not trying to get my cheeks clapped by whatever woman is out
right now." Wildin'.
So she goes back into her room. We hear her scream. Finally, there's some dick in this place.
I can't. Bro, this shit is like every amateur porno, bro.
I'm telling you.
The fuck?
And so, you know, but Marcus is trying to focus on his meat. So not his meat as in like his meat, but like his meat is in the competition.
Bro, shut up.
So we just in the house trying to get ready. So in the house, the AC and the electricity went off. Now we're in Miami. Ooh. Miami is like 90 to 100 degrees. So we're sitting in a hot box the whole time, almost in a sauna. And I mean, I couldn't even go take a shit without sweating. That's how bad it was in that house. And so the guy, the Airbnb owner, we had to call him and be like, "Yo, like, can you come and fix the electricity and the heat? Because nothing's working. Like, we can't even have a fan because the electricity isn't working. And so, like, they come fix the electricity, then they fix the heat the next day. So we slept in the heat and just sweated the entire time.
Yeah.
We ended up like struggling the entire time with sweat and no electricity, and you know, it was dark and dank and just so bad. We left that Airbnb because it was just a horrible experience, and left the box in the other side of the duplex and went to a hotel. So lo and behold, we have our stuff in our car. It's an important piece of the story. We have our stuff in the car. We're leaving the hotel after having our car to go to the venue, which is, once again, high performance gym. We're sitting around the gym in the car, you know, just driving around, getting ready for Marcus to weigh in. Marcus weighs in. I remember there's construction going on. There was a guy sitting in the construction site on his phone, not talking to anybody. And I'm like, you know, the whole time I'm thinking, that's strange that guy's just on his phone, not saying anything.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe he's listening to a podcast, right?
Mm-hmm.
Maybe he listens to the Husky Boys.
He might be listening to the Husky Boys, bro. You never know.
And so he's sitting there, you know, Marcus weighs in one time. He comes out, like, pees, spits, and then goes back and weighs again, makes weight. You know what you got? You got to do what you got to do, bro. And so we go inside. I'm handling Marcus because Marcus, so first point about being at a local meet, always have a coat.
Yeah.
I mean, your first meet, it's good to handle yourself just to know what you're doing, find out what the calls are, what the rules are. But your second meet, you might want to have someone do all that stuff for you so you don't have to think about anything.
Right. You only need to be focused on.
Right. You only want to be focused on executing your lifts, no matter what the weight is. So it's better to have a coach or a handler or just a friend who's there to like take care of things for you, tell you when your attempts are up, put your weights in for you, anything, just so you can only focus on doing a lift and going to sit down again. And so I'm handling Marcus. We're warming up we finished the squats. By the way, the gym was so packed. Like everybody had to double up on the racks. You know how, like, I don't know if you remember A&T, but at a power rack, the weight either on the inside or the outside of the rack.
Right.
People were squatting on the inside and the outside because it was so packed in that gym.
Damn.
So, like, it'd be one person squatting on the outside, the other person would be unracking the weight to squat as well. So somebody would be looking at somebody else's ass as they're squatting.
Yo, that's wild, bro.
I couldn't have done it. I would have left. I was like, look, this beat's not that important. Like, I don't care enough to be sitting there.
Yo, that's wild.
Marcus also had to squat first because the 83s were split into two categories. It was the heavy 83s are the people who had the heaviest weight they were lifting on the second flight, and then the light 83s on the first flight. And so Marcus is, of course, in the heavy flight. So he had to squat in flight A, which doesn't make sense. The heavier people should go last, not first. But I don't know.
they said, we only going to put this weight up here once. That's what they said.
So the heavy people should have been in flight A at the end, not in flight B at the beginning.
Right.
So, but anyway, so Marcus goes through his squats. He goes 2 for 3 on squats.
Mm-hmm.
Because he missed depth on one of them. And he couldn't warm up. I think Marcus jumped from 495 to like 630 on his first attempt just because he couldn't warm up.
What the fuck?
Hey, we all talk about this. The powerlifting progression.
God, bro.
Because people weren't squatting 630 when I was lifting.
Bro. That's ridiculous.
So, Marcus squats 630. That means squats 630 for his first attempt. Or maybe it was, might have been 605 for his first attempt. By the way, too heavy. Like the number.
When the fuck, bro? Heavy. Can we just talk, like, when the fuck did he get that? Because, like, he was in the fours. When you were hitting what 550?
Marcus kind of kept up with me, so I don't know if he was.
Oh, he was the same. Okay,
he was close to me at the very least. He was
okay. I was thinking you were like way higher than. Never mind. I was thinking you were way higher at first because I was gonna say when did this fucking jump come?
But that's what, bro. That's what I'm telling you. Is that if we had continued to lift, we would be right where Marcus is. Like, you, I was like, I'm guaranteeing
you. Bro, I mean, y'all would be squatting. I'd just be benching 6. I mean, you know.
Because I would be benching 6.
I mean, y'all can have that squat. I'll just bench that shit, you know?
Because, I mean, think about it. Like, that was 4 years ago, 4 or 5 years ago.
Yeah, that's true.
2019.
So he's been
4 years of progression.
How much has he been doing per year? Like 70? 70 to 100 pounds per year?
I don't know. Because I mean, it's not linear progression, right? It's kind of like on a logarithmic curve.
Okay.
Because you kind of tap, you peak out once you get to a certain point.
Right.
But he's, I mean, he's been making great progression.
But yeah, I was going to say, it sounds like he's been just going up.
Yeah. I mean, I think he put his last meet before this one, I think he might have put like almost 100 pounds on his total, maybe.
How?
If I'm not mistaken.
Nah, that nigga owns some shit, bro. Come on now. Come on, I'm gonna have to talk to Marcus, bro. How the fuck?
You gotta chill.
Man, how the fuck he had 100 now?
Nah, dude, I mean, I'm telling you, it's literally.
Does his form got better and shit?
Bro, it's form, it's consistency, it's having a coach there to coach you. It's having there to handle. Like, there's so many little things that add 5 pounds here, 10 pounds there, 10 pounds there. And when you do all those little things correctly at the same time, that's easily 100 pounds. I mean, just literally just the fact that you have a coach there to handle you and you can tweak your form and have someone there to critique you can add 50 pounds to your total easily. It has nothing to do with strength at that point.
Gotcha.
Then you get stronger by at least 50 pounds because you have the bench to squat and the deadlift to add weight on. That's 10 pounds on bench, 10 pounds on squat, and then maybe 30 pounds on deadlift, right? I mean, that's attainable. That's easily attainable.
Oh, I was thinking you said he added 100 to squat. That's what I was
thinking. Oh, not to the squat.
That's why I was like, hold up. That's sus.
He said that's sus.
How the fuck?
There's so many little things. We have so many topics to go over in future videos now, just like by this conversation. But like, there's so many little things you can do to improve yourself. In terms
so,
of
okay. All right. So for instance,
back to the meet. So story, Husky Boy Summer, right? So, I'm you know, Marcus finishes the squat. Of course, he's in the lead just because once again, everybody was competing for second. And so, we're kind of chilling. You know, I told Marcus, sit down, just, you know, wait until, I think at that point, I told him to start warming up for bench.
Yeah.
Not waiting 1 month, but, you know, get his shoulders ready. I don't know specifically what Marcus does for his entire bench warm up, just because I'm not like his coach, but I told him, you know, do whatever you need to do. You have about 15 to 30 minutes before you actually need to start doing 135, like all that stuff
in your
bench press warm ups. And so somebody comes up to me and they're like, hey, is this your passport? I'm like, what kind of random question I've ever gotten in my life?
Dog.
Like, a person walks up to you and tell you, is this your passport?
Nah, that's some wild shit.
No, that's not my passport. And so I'm like, I think your passport's up there. And I'm like, that's not my passport. I don't have my passport. Like, I don't even know if I brought my passport this trip. I walk up to the front where my passport is at, or where quote unquote my passport is at, and they're like, is this your passport? Is that you? And I'm like, nah, it's not me. And so they're like, you just look to be sure because it looks like you. So I'm thinking it's racist. I'm like, all niggas look alike, huh? You all of a sudden black people look alike. Huh? So I'm looking at the passport. I'm thinking I'm racist because I'm like, this look like me. And so I sit down and I'm looking at it. I'm like, yo, this is me. So my passport is real in the venue. So I'm like, oh, that's bad. Because if my passport is in the venue, that means I have my passport in my bag. If my passport was in my bag and it's in the venue, that means someone was in my bag.
Yeah.
So now I'm like, oh, no. So I asked them, I'm like, yo, who turned in my passport? And they're like, I don't know. Somebody just left it in the front. And so I go to the car. We had a Dodge Journey, you know, like one of those big, it's like big Dodge. But I mean, all Dodge cars are big, but like, it's like the big truck that's like three tiered seats. And it's like seven people or whatever.
Right.
We had one of those. We had our stuff in the trunk because once again, we came from the hotel because we had to check out and go to a different hotel because the Airbnb messed up.
Yeah.
I go to the car, I look in the trunk, my book bag's not there. I'm like, yo, that's not good at all. So I see my book bag's not there. I go back to the venue. I'm like, yo, did you have y'all seen a book bag? Anybody seen a book bag? They're like, nah. we just saw your passport. I'm like, they're like, did your stuff get stolen? I'm like, I hope not. I didn't see any. There's like, oh, none of the windows are broken or anything. So I thought maybe I just took my book bag out, or maybe Marcus took my book bag out and I didn't see it.
Yeah.
I go ask Marcus. Adeney was there. I don't know if you remember Adeney. He went to A&T. He's like the tall dude. I don't know if you remember. He used to squat like super glute dominant. Like he was always bent over in the squat because his legs were so long.
Yep, I remember.
Yeah, you remember him?
Yeah.
Yeah, he was there too. I went up to them. I was like, y'all didn't bring my book bag in, did you? And they were like, nah. And I was like, yikes, that's bad. So Adeney came into the car with me. He's looking at, because Adeney, I mean, he's pretty quick. So he's looking at all the doors. All of a sudden, Adeney sees, he's like, yo, someone popped a lock. I'm like, what's he mean? Like, he pulls the plastic part, like someone pulled this off. And I guess they had like a tool to open the lock with and then put it back on so you couldn't notice. And I was like,
y'all some professional.
I'm saying, bro.
Y'all had some professionals, bro.
And so
fuck.
Yo. So I look in the car. I mean, bro, I got my laptop stolen, headphones, all my art stuff. I had a necklace in there. It had to have been like at least $3,000 worth of stuff that they jacked in the car. Just because we had to kick out because we checked out of the hotel to go into a different one.
Fucking and Florida we, niggas, bro.
Bro, I'm telling you, Kodak Black.
Kodak Black, dude.
caught a lick, boy. Like, caught a hell of a...
So that's why you've kind of been unable to do videos for a little bit.
Yeah. So that's kind of one of the reasons why we haven't been doing any videos, because I just haven't had... I mean, I haven't had anything. Like, I have my phone, and I could barely charge it because they stole my chargers, too.
Any updates yet?
I haven't seen anything. I put a police report in. The police didn't even look like they cared, honestly.
Damn.
Like, the police was some essays. Like, they were like, hey, we don't know. We can do what we can do, but.
Damn, bro. Do you got, like, one of those, like, apps where you can track your laptop?
On Microsoft.com, you can, like, go in. So, if you have a Microsoft account, pro tip, you can put a tracker on your computer, yeah. And it'll tell you what your computer's location is. So even if you ever lose it, not necessarily if it gets stolen, if it gets connected to the internet in any way, it'll send you an email that, hey, we found your laptop, it's at this location, it's at this address, and you can like plug that into Google Maps and just go find it. But I mean, of course, they seem like they're pretty quick, because they didn't, the police, we went, me and Marcus went to multiple, not thrift stores, what do you call it? What's the word? Where you turn stuff in and you get money. What do you call
pawn
it?
Pawn shops?
Pawn shops. There we go. We went into multiple pawn shops and to go see if we could find our laptops. And not at none of the pawn shops did they have anything. They were like, yeah, the police already came through here. No one's turning anything in a while. And they were like, oh, okay, so they're smart. They know this stuff is hot, so they're not turning it in so they don't get caught.
Right. They seasoned, bro.
Right. And so... Back to the story. Me and Adeney are standing at the car. I'm like, I'm upset because I'm like, yo, I got my stuff. Like, I'm about to go to school. I needed my laptop. That's the one thing that I needed. And I didn't want to have to spend $1,000 to get another one right now.
Yeah.
And so I'm sitting there. We're sitting there, you know, we're like, the stuff got stolen. Someone popped the lock. This white guy comes over. He's like, hey, what are you guys doing right now? And I'm like,
Someone
stole stuff out of my car. Right. Listen. So,
what are you guys doing right now? The fuck is you doing right now? Like, hey, you walk up to me for.
And he's like, we're like, yeah, my stuff got stolen. He's like, hey, man, like about 30 minutes or so ago, I definitely saw two guys over here. And I saw one of them, they were at the front door. And one of them was like, he looked like he was doing something with the lock. And then he walked away. And then they walked away, and I was like, who? What did they look like? And he's like, you know,
He got scared? Like,
I was like, bro, go ahead and say some racist shit. Now it's time to not be racist.
Like, bro, 5'10", black male, right, dreads.
Tell me, dreads, just say every racist shit you can
do. Go with the stereotypical police report.
He was like,
age between 16 and 19.
Right. I was like, bro, were they black? Just tell me if they were black. Like, come on. He was like, yeah, they were black. I was like, okay, yeah. You know what else they look like? He was like, I don't know. One of them was kind of tall. One of them was kind of short. I was like, what were they wearing? He was like, one of them kind of had a red shirt. I'm like, bro, that was me. Like, that was me and my man. You are racist. Like, bro, if I was here 30 minutes ago, how you can't know who I am?
Hey, at least his heart was in the right place.
Hey, his heart was in the right place.
His eyes just don't fucking work.
We put in a police report. I haven't heard anything from the police. They haven't even told me that they gave up on it. I mean, I'm sure I'm not going to hear anything from the police. They're not going to find nothing.
I guess the best thing is to just try to monitor your laptop and hope it just ping up one day.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know.
It's sicko mode.
So yeah, go sicko mode on it. And so, I mean, just in that area, apparently there's thefts all the time. Like when I went back to Indiana, this one dude was like, "Yeah, man, bro, I parked my car last week and I got my stuff stolen there." And I was like, "What?" And then like I think even Ray Williams said that, because I was talking to Ray Williams' wife.
Yeah.
Even Ray Williams' wife was like, "Yeah, Ray got his stuff jacked the other day." And I was like,
"Bro, oh, and y'all wouldn't stuff. Like warn anybody?"
You got to give a warning.
Right, right. Oh. So how Marcus's meet go?
Oh, so Marcus's meet actually went great. I mean, well, Marcus, he didn't feel too good about it, cuz you know, he was going for an 1800 total. He wanted that 10 times
body. What'd he hit?
He was 1773, I think.
Bro, so
he was
that's
close. I mean, he's not far away at all.
That's insane.
And so we could have done a little bit better on selection. Marcus squad kind of went about as well as it could. The judges were holding him on depth, so we had to take the second attempt twice. I think he ended at like 639 on squad. We were trying to make up for it on bench, because if Marcus benched about like 412, he would have been within like eye shot that 1800 total. But he ended up with a 393. We definitely overshot the second attempt by a lot.
Okay.
And so because we overshot the second attempt, he was burned out for the third. He was just living getting it.
Right.
Which I should have made that. As a handler, I should have made that call. But he said he was feeling good on Ben. And our goal, it was the 1800 total. So I just let him go. I was like, all right, go for the heavy second. And then we'll try to go for the heaviest third, like really shoot on the third. Because Marcus's deadlift, I mean, Marcus deadlifts like a crackhead. Like, he can really just pull anything.
Oh, you need me to move this, bro? I got you.
Yeah, he's going to pull it. I mean, at least Marcus will always get two attempts on deadlift. He will never fail the second attempt. And so it doesn't matter what you put on there, he's going to pull it. It's just, if he pulls second attempt and he grinds it, the third one's probably not gonna come out. So that was kind of our plan. We're gonna go heavy on the bench. It might cramp his back a little bit, but then on deadlift, we just put whatever on there, get it done.
Yeah.
And so we overshot him second step on bench. He should have gotten a 402 max, but we ended up with 393 just because of the overshoot. And then on deadlift, I think we started with about 660 for his first attempt on deadlift. Second attempt, I think, was 683, I think.
Okay.
I don't remember. I'd have to go on the team lift or meet, whatever. I still can't remember what it's called.
Yeah.
But I'd have to go to the NC. So he got once again, Marcus deadlifts like a crackhead. So he got the second attempt. And we failed the third. I think for the third, we just said fuck it and put on like 700.
Okay.
And he pulled it for shits and giggles, but he didn't get it off the floor. I mean, he got it off the floor actually, and then he just quit on it. If he had stuck with it, he probably could have deadlifted it for 30 seconds and finished it. I honestly believe that.
But those be the hardest deadlifts though. When it's like it feels like it's not moving.
Yeah.
Those be the hardest one, like, cause like it take you forever to get to the lockout.
Because Marcus also is not, he's a short torso deadlifter. So like, he can't like, he can't just arch his back like Pete Rubish and
right.
have it come up. Like, he has to have a strict back. So if his back starts to bend, he just quits.
Yeah.
And that's the way you should.
I know that feeling.
To be arching on a deadlift.
Yeah. At all.
That's not safe.
It's not worth it. At least not until they start paying you millions.
No.
For them weights, boy.
And so he said he felt his back start to give out, so he just dropped it, which was the smart thing to do.
Right.
No need to stress at a local meet. That's another tip for a local meet. Local meets, do not risk your body for a
match. Yeah, not no local meet. There's no point. Maybe like at best, like at Worlds or something, but
yeah, it's
you not know, anything for you. You still got 50, 70, 80 more years to go, man. Like, you can't be giving out on one attempt.
No. And I mean, the best you'll get is a state record. State records don't mean anything for them.
Not really. Not when you go to Worlds and people like shit on you.
Yeah. Like, state records don't mean anything. Powerlifting has exceeded its grade.
Evolved,
so
bro.
That, yeah, it's evolved so far that
we're basically
state meet is as good as it is. In, like,
we're basically starting to get specialists, people that are just built. They not only have a perfect environment to lift, but they're built for lifting.
Right. Exactly.
You know, you see these guys with short arms, short legs. And, you know, the hardest thing for them is going to be deadlifting. But squat and bench right. is going to be, you know, their bread and butter.
Right. And then, I mean, deadlift is so...
You can learn to be a decent deadlifter. Right. Like,
people just figured out the deadlift. People just figured out the bench. People just figured out the squat. So whatever you're lacking, you could just get away with it.
Right. Point. You want to be... Like yeah. So tip, because we used to do this. Like, if you know you're weak in an area, you want that area to be, at minimum, the average for what that area is going to be. So if you're going to a meet and you know that, you know, the best lift for bench is going to be 400 and you can bench 350, you're still in the clear.
Right.
Because you can make those 50 pounds back up.
Yeah.
You know? And you want it to be as close as possible. Like, if your weakest lift is within, like, 10 or 20 pounds of the best lift, you might, like, crush that fucking competition.
Right. Exactly. And so, you know, the meet was good. I mean, Marcus, he just blew everybody out of the water. Only one person told him from the 40 whatever kg to the plus. Only one person told him higher.
Boy, balling out there, man.
And so Marcus is killing it. Next goal is nationals. He's gonna kill that too. So we don't see.
You going with the nationals too?
Yeah, I'm gonna go to nationals are right around my birthday. So
all right, bro. Do you need me to send you a camera? Long as it doesn't get stolen, I got like 3 or 4 cameras I can send you.
I don't trust anything anymore. So, I trust nobody.
Had to get you a damn GoPro and just strap that bitch to your arm,
bro. And we about to be in Chicago,
man. You gotta get some footage though.
Marcus got a camera worth paying for me.
Okay, that'll be fire. Because you know. To still be in that environment is dope. Like the competition day, even, you know, even if you don't have the best lifts, competition day is some shit, man. That shit is
it's
fun.
It's a different environment completely.
Yeah, it really reminds me of wrestling in high school. Is that type of feeling, to be honest. It's a little bit better because I was good at powerlifting, but
oh, you wasn't good at wrestling?
Hell no, I wasn't. Cause like. Dude, I don't know what it was, but wrestling just mentally didn't make sense to me until like the end of the season, and by then I didn't want to do it anymore. And I know that sounds weird, but it's like, it's just all the moves and, you know, feeling somebody else out, it just never, you know, rang with me. And
that's a lot.
Right. And so, you know, a lot of people told me, like, you know, if you would have stuck with it, you would have been fine, but I was like, I didn't like it anyway. I was doing it just to lose weight. So I could play football. So I took up swimming after that. But that's what it feels like, man. You go, you weigh in, you know, with people around you, and then you go and you compete. You know, you wait for your turn to compete. Like, that's it. It's that wrestling feel, that track feel. Like, it's a really chill environment until like right before you're about to do something. Right. And then, you know, even if you're not putting up, you know, super numbers and stuff, being there and seeing people do great things. Like, I remember seeing that one-arm deadlifter, or that one-arm lifter. I'm not going to say deadlifter. One-arm lifter. Yeah. Because he was benching, like, 175 and he was deadlifting like 300. I was like, dude, how the fuck are you doing this shit?
Right, yeah.
I think he squatted like 4 something.
I wish I could remember his name. I don't remember his name.
I don't know.
I think we put his name in the video.
Yeah, the old me. Yeah. He was a dope dude. I was really glad to meet him. And then you just meet all types of people. Like, definitely, you know, at some point in your life, if you're really passionate about powerlifting, definitely do it. And if you can't, if you don't want to do it, if you're scared to perform, like, volunteer.
Volunteer. Right. Be a spotter. Be a loader.
They always need spotters and loaders and stuff, man. Always. And you need good ones, too. Like, especially if you're one of those people that hates when somebody can't spot you. Because wasn't it, I swear I was watching Worlds and there was, like, a scratch or something that was just bad.
Yeah, it was like, I think it was like 2016, 2017 Worlds that had the worst spotting of all time.
Yeah.
It was when Worlds was in the United States.
It was really bad. It was like, really bad, bro. People were
out here like, people were on their knees with unsquat. I shouldn't be getting ready to suck dick during a squat. That doesn't make sense.
You bet. If I'm a squat this big ass weight, your ass better catch it. That's
you
all
better catch it.
It's not, you got 6 people. It's not hard. Everybody just put their 2 hands on that shit and push it up.
Right.
Like, I don't care how much weight you got. You got 6 motherfuckers that lift, you'll be all
right. Right. You know, there's a spotting and loading class. Like,
based on what I've seen in the gym, I believe there's a spotting and loading class. I believe it's necessary for a spotting and loading class, motherfucker. I believe that. Especially
spot you with one hand,
man. That's just one of them things where, like, even if people were smart enough to figure it out, like, you need that just so people don't kill each other, man.
Right, exactly. Exactly. I mean, that's how I hurt my hip with dude trying to spot me crazy,
trying to make you do too much and shit like that, man. Y'all be careful in the motherfucking gym, bro. You only got one body, and you need that shit to last if you want to have fun. So, you know, take that shit serious. If you doing a set and somebody's fucking you up, like, tell them to get the fuck out of the way and get somebody else.
For real.
Or just, you know, or just stop the set if you have to. Like, one day is not going to hurt you. It's going to suck because you're going to be, like, unhyped. It's going to be anticlimactic. But it's not worth risking injury, man. It's really not.
We're going to go over, actually, that's another video. We're going to go over rules for looking for a spotter in the gym.
Bet.
There's a technique.
I like that one, bro.
We gonna go over what to look for in a spotter.
Upcoming. Next few days, next week, whatever. Husky Boy's gonna teach y'all how to pick out a motherfucking spotter in the gym. On baby, motherfucker. That's it for today, y'all. Comment, like, and subscribe. Peace out.